Oh, my granddaddy always said that the ultimate story about the ultimate gift had to start in the beginning. And so that's the way he did it. He started in the beginning. Now, in the beginning, according to the Bible, God made everything. You know, you've heard the story. He made the stars. He made the moon. He made the sun. He made the rivers and the valleys and the creeks. He made the ponds. And you know, when we ride into them big old meadows with all the wildflowers in the spring when we're in southern Colorado, he made them too. He also made people. And he made this couple, and you've probably heard the story, but maybe not told this way. And their names were Adam and Eve. And boy, they had the run of everything. Yeah, I'll take one of them too. That looks good. Man, I tell you what, that's something. Oh. So speaking of eating, let me get back to it. They could eat anything that they wanted in the Garden of Eden, except for one thing. And my grandpappy said, through rebellion and disobedience, they ate it anyway. Have you boys ever done something you knew you shouldn't do and you done it anyway? It's kind of like that, but it was with Grandpappy said, great consequences. Great consequences. So what happens, a curse was put on the world. Hey, Randy, you know when you take Brenda, when she's making peanut butter cookies, and you bring her a rose and it's got them thorns on it, it wasn't supposed to be. And that cactus over yonder was smooth as a baby's hind end before that curse. It was. And Grandpappy said that man was separated from God by that whole ordeal. But he had a plan. He always does, I think. He had a plan. That plan had a name. Named Jesus. You've heard. You've heard of him. But maybe not in this way. So many, many years later, boys, there was a young girl named Mary. And she was quite the young gal. She was they said she was a good gal. And she was engaged to become married to an old boy named Joseph, who was a carpenter. He made furniture like old Sandy Jackson does back home. Good furniture. No nails. They didn't have them. They just all fit together good. One night, this is where it gets good. One night, an angel came to Mary. And the angel told Mary, you're going to have a baby and it's going to be sired by the Holy Ghost. You've been picked among all women and this baby's going to be the Savior of the world. The Messiah is what they called it. And let me tell you, she was so excited, she was high-stepping all the way over to Joseph's place. And she told Joseph this story, and, well, I could take some of that. She told Joseph this story, and let me tell you, Randy, he wasn't near as excited. Oh, no. He wasn't excited as she was. Well, matter of fact, he did get excited. He thought that she was lying to him and maybe she'd been unfaithful and everything else. And let me tell you, when that got out amongst the town people, oh, the tongues went to wagging. Woo! Gossip was just filling the streets. And people started judging and accusing. And they was having a big old time, Butch. Because that's how people are. And so God had a plan here too. You think this is kind of a tough spot to be in? Well, an angel came to Joseph and said, Joseph, Mary's telling the truth. And she is going to have a baby sired by the Holy Ghost. And that baby's going to be the Savior of the world, the Messiah. And then the last thing he said, and John, he was looking at him just like I'm looking at you, this angel was, and said, you're going to name him Jesus. You're going to name him Jesus. Woo! Yeah, that's the name, remember, to fix everything from back yonder. We'll get to that in a minute. Now, there's something else that was going on at the time. The government was run by Romans. According to my grandpappy, they run almost the whole world at the time. And they put out this, they call it a decree. I never could say that right, but what it means is something they'd nail on a wall and you had to read it and do what it said. And what it said was everybody had to return to their town of their origin. Now, if you boys don't know what that means, it's kind of like Quartz from Laredo, but that don't mean he goes back to Laredo. It means he goes back to where the family originated from, which I think is Boston. I know you don't like to talk about it. It's better than New York City. And so Mary and Joseph, they headed out that very next morning for Bethlehem. Yeah, it was a long trip too. As they made their way there, you got to understand, she was heavy with child at the time, so they was moving very slow. And everybody else that was going to Bethlehem to sign up for that census, that's the thing where they want more taxes. Anybody know what I'm talking about? But everybody else beat them there because they were moving so slow. And when they got to town, all the hotels were full up. Them hotels were fuller than a tick on a hound dog's back. There was no way they could get in. And so, but they found a little stable on the edge of town. Now I know you boys are thinking, hey, I've stayed in stables many times, and let me tell you, there's nothing like dry bedding and a wind block to make a good night's sleep. But you got to remember, this wasn't just a stable, it was kind of a cave, and she was getting ready to have a baby. But they settled in, and she was in labor. But at the very same time, Bethlehem was known for raising, their ranchers around there raised a special kind of stock. You know what it was? Well, they were shepherds, and I know you don't have much love for shepherds. But I'm telling you, these were different kind of shepherds, and they raised spotless sheep. So them shepherds were out there guarding their flocks, according to Grandpappy, and their sheep by night. And they seemed to be just kind of moseying along, taking care of business, if you know what I mean, just like we do. And then shepherds were out there just walking, and everything was quiet. Kind of like a silent night. You probably heard that song before. And just look up, boys, look at them stars. Yeah, it was just like that. The stars were out, the same stars that God made. And it was quiet, and it was peaceful. And they was just doing their job. And boys, you got to hear this part. You know what broke the silence that night? Well, they got to a certain place. And all of a sudden, the sky lit up. And I'm telling you, it lit up. It lit up like, remember when we were in Dodge City and seen that Chinese fireworks thing? Woo! And the sky was lit up. Well, this was lit up, and it was lit up with angels. Angels. And all them angels were flapping their wings and carrying on. Scared the horses. It would have scared the horses, Butch. It would have. I tell you who it scared. It scared them shepherds. And it would have scared you too if the sky would have lit up in the middle of the night like that. And them shepherds were fearful. But the angel said, it was like this. It said, don't be afraid. Them wings. Don't be afraid. We bring good news and good tidings and such as that. And they went on to say, this is the night that the Savior of the world has been born in a little stable on the edge of town. I'm telling you what, it was a big deal. And the angels went on to tell them, this will be the King of Kings and he's going to change everything. And we picked you to go see him first. Or they said something like that. I don't have the book with me, but it was something like that. And they said, this is how you'll find him when you get there. You'll find Mary and you'll find Joseph and you'll find that baby wrapped in what they said was swaddling clothes. Now, I didn't know what that was for years. Little strips of rags. It's kind of like just to keep him warm. Because they were in a stable. They weren't ready for this. So just as suddenly as those angels appeared, they disappeared right into the night. And everything got dark again. Now, the shepherds were looking at each other like, what do we do next? And somebody said, let's do what the angels said. So they went over to see what the angels had told them. And when they got there, and it was a short trip, by the way, and when they got there, what they found was just like they'd said, Joseph and Mary and the baby and them swaddling stuff. And they worshiped him. But now I got to tell you something about the shepherds. Now, you boys know when we ride into a town and we are kind of feel like we're outsiders, you know the feeling, everybody's kind of looking at us and we don't belong. And Ken, how many times have we been rode up to the outside of a church? We would ride up to the outside of a church and look in the window and worship from out there because we didn't feel like we could go inside. Now, I don't know why, Randy. I don't know if it's because we didn't belong in the community or we weren't dressed in the proper clothing or our boots were muddy, whatever it was. And I ain't saying it's right. I'm just saying it's the way it is. We were outsiders. But, you know, these shepherds, they were the outsiders of the outsiders. They wouldn't even let them go to town. At least they let us come in, spend our money. Outsiders of the outsiders. So when my grandpappy used to tell me this story, I used to think, why did they tell the shepherds? This whole announcement ordeal, why wasn't that told to the kings of the world? Or the rich folk? Or even the folk in town? It didn't make any sense to me till one day, the answer hit me like lightning standing on top of my horse on top of a mountain in mid-July with a storm rolling in from the west. I'm talking clear. It's because this Jesus had come to be king for everybody. Not just the higher ups. It was for everybody. The same reason he was born in a shelter, a sheep shelter. The same reason he came to the shepherds in the middle of the night. All mankind. Well, them shepherds, just like we got to go to work in the morning if we're going to be home Christmas evening, they had to get up and they had to head back to the flocks. That was their job, and they went. But let me tell you, this story just gets better, doesn't it? Because when they were doing that, there was another group of guys. They was called the wise men. And I guess they knew a lot of stuff. And they called them the Magi, according to Greg Grampy. Magi. Isn't that a cool name? Woo! I love it. These guys had studied about the coming of this Savior, the Messiah. And they were following a star because they studied all the star stuff. And this star was leading them hundreds of miles. Guys, I'm telling you, on foot, they might have had a camel or two, but it was a long way. And they came to where Mary and Joseph and the baby were. And they brought them gifts. Now, this is what they brought them. The one sat down. I'll take one of them. Yeah. Good apple. The one sat down, gold was his first gift. Now, my grandpappy said he sat down gold because this was going to be the King of Kings for all times. Then the second one sat down, frankincense. Now that was an oil that they high priests used in the temple back in them days. And I guess what it represented is he wasn't only king, he was high priest. Then the third one sat down what's called myrrh. And this is kind of a bittersweet definition, to say the least, because this is what they used in death to rub the body down. So he was The King of Kings was born to die, to fix all that mess we talked about earlier. Now, them wise men, they worshiped for a while, and they had to get up, and they had to get back to work, too. Boys, you want to hear the rest of the story? Let me get a drink. You got that coffee? Now, that baby Jesus grew up. And he lived a perfect life. Can you imagine that? He lived a perfect life. And at an appointed time, he went and he died on a cross for the sins of the world. And everything changed then. Salvation had come, what Grandpappy said. And my great-grandma said, hope had come. But boys, I got to tell you something. My heart is heavy tonight here around this fire. There's something I haven't told you, boys. Ken knows. We've rode together a long time. You know, the ultimate story of the ultimate gift I've been telling you guys. I received that gift. I did. And what's making my heart so heavy is I never told you. I don't know why I didn't tell you. I don't know if it was because I was prideful. I didn't know if it was because I was scared. I ain't scared of too many things, but maybe I was afraid you guys would laugh. I don't know what it was, but I can't keep looking back at the regrets in my life anymore. I can't keep looking back at what I should have done or could have done or any of them things. I got to look forward and say, what can I do right now? And just like putting an old stake in the ground, I want to do the right thing here tonight. And I want to tell you, boys, the story of how I got the gift. You want to hear it? Well, years ago, Court, I was probably about your age, and man, I was just filled with vinegar. Woo! Me and Ken, we was driving a herd of Mexican cattle up out of El Paso. That's when we'd get any cows we could bring. It wasn't these good breeds like now. And about the time we got to the Texas Panhandle, I was telling Ken, I said, I cannot wait to spend every penny that I'm going to make when I get to Abilene. You see, Randy, money used to burn a hole in my pocket in a fierce way. I could not wait to spend it. But now I'm married with a family. I don't have to worry about that because it never goes in my pocket. So we brought that herd in early in the morning. Remember, it was a fog so thick that you couldn't even see your nose on your face, Butch, I'm telling you. We brought that herd in and put them in the stockyard. The cattle were quiet. They were lowing. And we put them cows in there. Me and Ken, we walked down the main street early in the morning. I could smell bacon cooking. And I said, let's go get ourselves some breakfast. We had that money in our hands. Remember, I'd been calculating all the way up how I was going to spend this money, so it was just fresh on my mind, let me tell you. So when we got there, and we was eating breakfast, and I told Ken, I said, the last time I take that napkin and wipe across my mouth, I'm going to get up and I'm going to walk across that street to the mercantile, and I'm going to buy myself a new hat. Remember that ragged hat I wore for years? It's gone. And I'm going to buy myself a new shirt, some new breeches, and some new boots. So when that napkin came across my mouth for the last time, I laid it down and folded it up. I got up and I walked across that street. When I come out, I was carrying boxes and bags. Boxes and bags. I was a rich man. And that's when that bathhouse used to be on the east end of town. It ain't there no more. That's where the doctor's office is. And they moved the bathhouse into the hotel. But back then, it was that old shanty out there. And I walked in and I said, I held my money up. I was a bit of a boaster in them days. Held my money straight up and I said, I want a haircut, a shave, and some smelly sauce put on me. Yeah, I took a bath. When I come out of that place with my new duds on, I stepped onto that street, and let me tell you, I was shining like a new penny on a midday sun. I was just, woo! I was looking good, I was feeling good, and Randy, I was smelling good. Hard to believe, wasn't it? I was strutting down the street like a young rooster. I had the world by the tail. My whole outfit was slicker than a gut wagon, and let me tell you, I was looking good. And I noticed there was posters on each side of the road, and Ken was walking with me. And these posters said, there was a hoedown that night, a get-together out at the pavilion. And you know the old pavilion on the other end of town? That's when it was brand new. I know that thing's getting ready to fall down now, but it was brand new then. Well, I took one of them posters down, and I was reading it. And it said, come and you'll find music. It said, come and you'll find food. And then it said, come and you'll find drink. And it dawned on me, that's where I'm going to spend the rest of this money. And I'm going to save just enough to get back down to Texas and get on another drive heading north. So I went down there, me and Cannon. They had good food and the music was playing. And the drink was a little skimpy for what I was expecting, but it was lemonade and such. And I got myself a plate of food. And Ken always had the knack of fitting in better than I did. He just sat right down there and listened to the music. And me being kind of an outsider, I went out onto the bench out there on that south end of the whole deal. And I took a great big bite of food. And as I was chewing it, I was listening to the songs playing. And there was banjos and fiddles, but I didn't hear no Camptown Races sing this song, doo-da, doo-da. You know, our favorite song. But the lyrics to them songs, they was talking about that fella from my story earlier named Jesus. And I thought, well, that's okay. And I took another great big bite when I looked up, and lo and behold, there was a young girl staring right at me. Or at least I figured she was, just in case I looked around. But when I looked back, she was halfway to me. Inside, I was thinking, what am I going to do next? And I almost choked on my mouthful of food, and I finally got her down as she sat down next to me. And I'll never forget what she said. You guys want to hear this? She sat down all proper and such, and she said, isn't it a beautiful evening out? Can you imagine that? Dawn, she said, isn't it a beautiful evening out? I'd never heard something so pretty in my life. Isn't it a beautiful evening out? And so me, with my vast vocabulary, I thought, I'll answer her. And my tongue was tied. All I could get out was, yep. Well, feeling like a fool, she looked up at the sky. Look up, boy. It was just like this. She looked up at the sky. Evening had come and the stars were just shining. And she said something that changed my life. And let me tell you, she said, the heavens declare the glory of God. Now, my tongue had gotten loose. I was ready to talk now. Woo! And I said, that sure is a pretty poem. And she said, that isn't no poem. She said, that's from the Bible. That's Psalm 19, verse 1. And you know how I can remember that? It got branded onto me just like a young calf at deer horning. It just branded onto me, let me tell you. Psalm 19, verse 1. The heaven declareth the glory of God. Isn't that pretty? And it says a lot if you get to thinking about it. But the next thing she said, and she started telling me the story that my pappy told me, told by his grandpappy, that I've told my kids, that I told you boys here tonight. The ultimate story of the ultimate gift. And she laid it out, boy. She did it better than I did. She had the proper talking. It was almost like she had the book. And when she got done telling this story, she looked at me and said, I got two questions for you. I figured I can handle two questions. I was a little rattled, but two ain't too bad. I said, go ahead. And she said, do you want to receive the gift that I just talked about, the ultimate gift from the ultimate story, the Christmas gift? And I didn't answer. Oh, no, I didn't say a word. I sat there as quiet as a frog on a log. But her second question, she said, "And can I pray with you?" Well, let me tell you, everything within me was saying, "No, no, no." I said, "No way, Jose." All this was inside. I wasn't saying it. And inside of myself, I felt like I'd roped a buffalo and dallied off on a pony saddle set on a donkey. I was being drugged down the road. You guys got an amen, don't you? And I was being drugged down the road, not of my own accord. And as I was saying, "No, no, no," I sat down. And boys, I said, "Yes." It ain't easy to talk about for me because it changed my whole life. Everything was different after that. I said, "Yes." Boys, I got two questions for you here tonight. That ultimate story of the ultimate gift, does anybody here want to receive the gift of Christmas tonight? And my second question is, can I pray with you? Me and Ken. Okay. I've got a question for everyone here tonight. Actually, two questions. Remember, two questions you can handle. This is my first question. Is there someone here that wants to receive the Christmas gift? Now, remember the ultimate story of the ultimate gift, Jesus Christ. And to receive that ultimate gift, you don't have to jump through hoops. You don't have to say anything a certain way. It's a heart decision when you say yes. Now, you probably wonder, what am I going to get out of this? Let me tell you, you'll get a lot. You'll have peace. You'll have purpose. You'll receive the gift of salvation. You'll live forever. You'll be adopted into the family of God. And let me tell you, that was enough for me. But wait, there's more. You'll belong to a body of believers, brothers and sisters. You'll receive the Holy Spirit who will guide you, comfort you, interpret the things of the world, especially the Bible, and will keep you. It is the ultimate gift. And the story I just told is the ultimate story. It's the story. So the first question, who wants to accept it? The second question was, can I pray with you? Let's just close our eyes together right here tonight. Now you might be sitting here going, "You know, I got roped into this thing. I feel like that fellow that roped the buffalo." But God knew you'd be here tonight. He knew this would be the night that you said yes. And see, Scripture says today is the day of salvation, and it says that because you're not guaranteed another breath. So if you want to receive that gift, I'm going to pray, and you just pray along with me. Just something like this. Lord, I just want that gift. It's that simple. I want that gift. And I want to receive salvation. I want to receive eternal life. I want to receive the Holy Spirit. I want purpose. I want all the promises. I want to belong to a group of believers. I want to have a future. I don't want to keep looking at my past. And Lord, I know you'll fill me in on the rest of it. I believe that you died on the cross for the sins of the world. I believe that you were buried, that you rose again on the third day, and you ascended on high to intercede for all of us at the right hand of the Father. And I believe that you're going to come back and set things right. And Lord, I receive you with that prayer from my heart, not my head, in the name of Jesus. Amen. And let's keep our heads down. If there's someone here tonight that received that gift, just lift your hand. It's okay, I'm the one looking. Let's keep the lights down. I want nobody else looking. Just raise your hand. Receive the gift tonight. Receive it. Keep your eyes down. God bless all of those who want the gift tonight. God's got purpose and plan for you. Now, for the rest of you, I don't know what happened to you. I can tell you what happened to me through the years. But whatever's caused you to be distant from God, whatever's caused you from stop telling the story to your family, whatever it is from that stopped you from claiming the promises, whatever it stopped you from feeling the joy and the peace and the presence of God, tonight's the night that God says, come home to me, my child. Come home to me. With a show of hands, who wants to come home to him tonight? God bless you and you, hands all over the room. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for this ultimate story of the ultimate gift that changed everything, even outsiders. And Lord, we praise you for all that you've done in our lives and all that you're going to do in our lives. Lord, change us incrementally. Lord, go through the rooms of our hearts with a renovation plan that will make us stronger and better and more effective and more spiritually fit follower of Christ than we could ever possibly have thought we could be. A better witness. And with Holy Spirit power, help us to lead our families. Help us to pray for our country. Help us to pray for our enemies. And help us to represent you in a mighty way in this troubled world. And we ask these things in the precious and righteous and holy name of Jesus Christ. And everybody said, amen. Now you can hit the lights. Anybody happy? Woo! Now we're going to sing a couple of songs, and then we're going to eat all kinds of goodies. And the only thing I got to say before is, you know that the canned goods you brought are for families in need. As you leave, we're going to take an offering, and it's not for us. It's to adopt some families to get them through the winter. If you want to give, that's fine. If you don't, but there'll be buckets at the end. I also wanted to invite anybody who wants to come back tomorrow morning at 9:30. We're going to bring that campfire right down here. And we're going to gather around it. And we're going to sing some hymns just like we do when we're at Eagle Ranch. And we're going to give testimonies. And we're going to pray for everyone here. We're going to pray for all the believers in the world. We're going to pray for our nation. We're going to pray for the world, the body of Christ, universal, here tomorrow morning. And then we're going to get up and we're going to clear off the stage. Woo! That was the only catch. And set up for worship for next week. So let's sing together. And cast and crew, come on up and fan out across here. There'll be a photo op too if you've brought your cameras or you got grandkids. Hit it. Thank you. I've met so many new people tonight. The thing I really want you to leave here with is, you know, we're inundated with Black Friday and just all the stuff. I mean, it makes me into a Scrooge. You know what I'm saying? But this Christmas season is about Jesus Christ, and it's about salvation, and it's for the outsiders. It's for everyone. So go out this year and have a new attitude about it. Serve at a soup kitchen. Do something just radically off the chart different. You know, we were witnessing to a man yesterday that said, went through a bad divorce, all he had was a cold case of beer, a pickup, a Harley, and a horse. And Brenda said, you'll fit right in. You know what I'm saying? Let's get out there and let's stop being religious zombies and let's show people that Jesus Christ came to deliver all people. So let's go have some cookies and let's have a great time, okay? God bless you guys.
Cookie monster.